Jay Trimble is a member of the Intelligent Systems Division at NASA Ames Research Center. He is the Mission Operations and Ground Data System Manager for the Resource Prospector Lunar Rover mission. Prior to this, Jay founded and led the User-Centered Technology Group, bringing design thinking to space operation software, including open-source mission control technologies, the MER board touchscreen for Mars rover operations, and planetary data system user technologies. At UC Berkeley, Jay was the integration and test manager for the high-energy solar spectroscopy imager. At JPL, he was lead operations director for Space Radar Lab, which flew two successful missions on the Space Shuttle Endeavour. He was a member of the science operations support team for the Voyager spacecraft anchored with Neptune. At Johnson Space Center, Jay was a Space Shuttle mission controller in the payload discipline. Jay has a bachelor's degree in geology from UC Berkeley and a master's degree in computer science from USC. Let's give a warm welcome to Jay Trimble.
All right, well, so as you can see from the title, I'm going to talk about operational issues in exploring the lunar poles, and I'm going to ground that in some mission specifics for our planned lunar rover, but try and make it generalizable enough that hopefully it'll be useful to you for lunar port design. So, Admiral Rickover, he was a Navy admiral, and these words really stuck with me through my career, and I don't know if it's familiar to anybody here, but he's got a quote that's fairly well known, and he's talking about nuclear reactors, and he's saying the academic nuclear reactor is very small, it's light, it's low cost, it's in the study phase, like what you guys are doing. But then when you have to actually build that nuclear reactor, it becomes expensive. And what really stuck out to me is significant development resources on apparently trivial elements, you know, the kind of thing that in a study you can, you know. So for example, let's say you want surface autonomy. For the sake of a study, you don't have to design it. You can just assume it. Anyway, my broader point here is that it's really exciting for me to be here with you watching this study because you have room to innovate and come up with amazing big ideas that could build the future. And it's much harder to do that when you're bogged down with those apparently trivial items, spending all your resources on that. So anyway, excited to see what comes out of the next couple of days. I only put this up there because I'm curious if you've heard this, because we say this in NASA when we talk about ISRU. Is this familiar to anybody? Is this saying like out there in the world, or is it only a yes? Yes, no? Okay. Anyway, you know, rocks to blocks, dust to thrust. The ISRU community in NASA likes to throw those words around, so I thought it was kind of fun. So, Resource Prospector, still in the early formulation phases, but we hope we fly in the next 5 years. Exploration driven. What does that mean? Well, two things. One, it means it's funded by the human exploration side of NASA as opposed to the science mission directorate. But on a practical side, it means that we are trying to map the volatiles at one of the poles of the moon to understand the distribution for resource utilization. So we do have a science team, and we are going to get data that will be useful in determining the mechanisms of volatile emplacement and distribution and where the sources are and where the sinks are. That's the fundamental science, and we'll get data to support that. But our mission goals are driven by the exploration side, which says map those volatiles so we understand where they are, so that if we ever are actually going to build a lunar port, we'll know where to go. And then we'll have an ISRU demonstration, which I'll talk about a few slides in. So we actually, on the ops team for Resource Prospector, spend most of our time talking about how to operate on the surface, but landing is not something I want to take for granted, since obviously we have to land in one piece in order to do our surface mission. I wanted to point out, for anybody who is thinking operations, the difference between a critical phase and a decisional phase. So if you are landing people on the moon and you have a mission control center on the ground, right, you can make mission consequential decisions, right? If anybody's familiar with that first ascent to the surface and the ground communications with Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin, right, there were computer alarms, mission control was in the loop on decisional things. This is all going to be automated. And I would expect what you will do will probably be automated as well. So it is critical. There will be people huddled around screens, but those people will not be making decisions. They'll be watching an automated sequence play out. And we just go in directly. We do not go into orbit first. And operationally, if someone were to suggest you go into orbit first, you say, okay, what am I going to do? I'm going to get this data. Is that data decisional? Am I all of a sudden going to be rethinking my landing site? Am I going to spend a month debating this? But those are the kinds of things we have to think about in operations. So if somebody, one of the engineers, comes to me and says, well, we're going to go into orbit first, I go back and tell them, okay, now I have to get this data, have decision criteria for it, and train for it. So seemingly small things can actually become big things when you get to operations. These are our mission requirements. This is the top level stuff that we're supposed to do from the NASA headquarters level. We're going to the poles. You all know, right? It's very dark at the poles, and we are a solar powered rover. So we have to balance being able to go where we have power versus access to the shadows, which is where the volatiles are most likely to be. These are our level two mission requirements. I don't know if this sort of thing is familiar to folks, and I'm putting it out there more just to show you the way we build requirements at NASA, which then become missions. So minimum success, okay, that's what we have to do to be minimally successful. We are considered fully successful if we get what we've got written down into that second set of bullet points, but really where we want to get to is the stretch goals. Strategic knowledge gaps, has anybody heard of this? Right, so this is the structured way we put things together and we say, okay, you know, this is what we need to know to go use the resources of the moon. This is what we don't know. If you want to get a mission through, and you can see where our mission relevance is relative to these, and I'm not going to go through these, that's where we sit. And we are addressing enough of these strategic knowledge gaps to be the next mission to the moon. Okay, so very simple. Map the surface. I'll talk about the instruments we're going to use to do that. Go into the shadows. Right now, if you had a nuclear-powered rover, going into the shadows wouldn't be quite as dramatic as a solar-powered rover using batteries. Expose the regolith using a drill. Capture it. I'm going to go quickly through this because I have a lot of slides and I have other slides that talk about these. Okay. Capture it. Process it. Understand what's in it. And then if we're lucky, maybe we'll have a few water droplets and take a picture of those, and that would be the first picture of water off the Earth, which we think would be very cool. And also that's something that the public can relate to, right? Because I don't think if you look at most of this, determine type and quantity of volatiles in the lava subsystem with those chemical formulas, I don't know that the public's going to get too excited about that specifically, but water and pictures of water on the moon, I think the public would get very excited about. Okay, so this is the whole system. So we have a mobility system. Now, how many of you, when you get into your car, say, wow, I'm going to go use the mobility system? I'm guessing none. And I don't do that either. And when I first saw that, I thought, you know, God, only we would say something like that. But I think from a design standpoint, it actually does get you thinking at a different level of abstraction. If you say, okay, I need mobility, right? It gives you different options than saying, I need to drive a rover. You could imagine snaking around. You could imagine if you wanted to just sample things 100 kilometers apart, you could lob projectiles. Anyway, there's a lot of different ways to do it. But my point is this nerdy stuff might get you thinking at a different level of abstraction. So as we are driving, we're always in prospecting mode. And the neutron spectrometer, that's our sniffer. So that says, okay, there's hydrogen. It's not going to tell you if it's water or the composition, but it is going to tell you that there is hydrogen. So the science team has to decide when a concentration of hydrogen warrants further exploration. When they make that decision, we can get into a search pattern, we can stop, we can drill, we can auger, and we can use the nervous then to determine the actual composition of what that neutron spectrometer has shown us. Then, if they decide that it's worth the time, and when I say worth the time, we've got a week on the surface, okay? So we have to really choose what we are doing wisely. So then we can drill core, we can extract it, we can heat our sample up in the oven, and then we can use lava to determine the actual composition of that sample. So that's kind of the mission in a nutshell. And if folks, I know some of you have been to NASA, some of you have been to SpaceX, a lot of the emphasis in the early formulation phase of a mission tends to be the documentation and the study. But we built a fully functioning prototype. We built the rover. We've done the payload hardware. We integrated all that. We tested our concept of operations, which had a team in California, a team in Florida, a team in Texas doing mission control. The rover was also at a rock yard in Texas. So it was really hard to get those guys away from the rover and doing their mission control job. But we built this, tested it, validated our core concept of operations. There are differences between operating in Texas and operating on the moon. Not just the gravity, but also the moon is in the shadow regions at the poles. Those are among the coldest regions of the solar system. And I can tell you Texas in the summer is probably among the warmer spots in the solar system. Okay, so here's a conceptual what this looks like. You can see the neutron spectrometer, right? We're sniffing. And I'm thinking, if you think Mars exploration rovers are more like, I think of that as a geologist with a hand lens. That's a gross oversimplification, but I think you know what I mean. I think of this as more a person with a metal detector. You know, this guy's running around on the beach looking for metal or whatever, and they're kind of prospecting. So we're closer to that than we are that geologist with the hammer and the lens. So we drive, we sniff, we find something, we can drill an auger, we use that NIRVIS, the near-infrared spectrometer, dump it into the oven, analyze it with lava. Sounds simple. Hopefully it will be simple. And what we get as we're doing that is a heat map, right? So we're gonna have this map, this sniffing map we go as we drive our kilometer or however far we get of the surface distribution of hydrogen, and then spots where we've done further analysis. So that's what it will look like in a nutshell. And of course, the science team's just chomping at the bit to see this stuff. All right, so you know what? I think I've said enough of this, and I've got a lot of slides that I can just move on and talk a little bit about operations. So I'm curious, when you think about designing for space, how many of you actually think about how you're going to operate it? Okay, only a couple. So, or maybe you guys are being shy, I don't know. And it is, so, you know, what you design, how you operate something is largely baked in by the design assumptions that you make. So if you take the space shuttle, for example, it used auxiliary power units for hydraulics for the aerosurfaces. And there were three of those redundant, and they had very tight fuel margins. And throughout the life of the shuttle program, which was decades, right, those fuel margins for those APUs had to be managed. And if you ever listen to a shuttle countdown, you'll hear the call-outs for APU start, which is auxiliary power units. And if you ever watched a scrub, you know, you'd realize that once those APUs were started, there were only minutes of margin. And that's an example of the kind of thing that you make the engineering decisions based on the best data you have, and then operationally you have to manage that through the life of whatever your space asset is. And there's lots more examples like that. So now it's fairly standard to have ops people involved from the design phase. Okay, so just a couple of quick definitions here. And I don't know how many people have heard these terms or not, but the mission operations system, that's people, processes, those mission control teams, flight rules, procedures, all the tools you need to make the decisions during operations. And then the ground data system, right? That would be the mission control facilities, the software you're using for planning or trajectory analysis, all the tools. And then you put those two together and you get the mission system. Now, right, you guys have the chance to think big. There's nothing that says that all of that stuff has to be done on the ground. Some of it could be done in space. Very interesting trade space to think about. Okay, so a little bit more specific. The first thing I think about when I think of operations is command and control, because if you can't command and control your space assets, none of the rest of it matters a lot. Planning, which I'll talk about a little bit more in detail. Trajectory, if you're in space, where are you? Traverse, if you're on a surface, where are you? Health of the vehicle, if you look at the human spaceflight mission control centers, most of those positions are looking at vehicle and system status. I think the ISS, and don't hold me to this because I'm going from memory, has about 160,000 engineering parameters that are analyzed on the ground. That's a lot of eyes. And part of the reason for a control center on the ground, right, is you just don't have that screen real estate and that number of eyes up in space. And going back to the Apollo example, and if anybody's ever listened to it, listen to the first descent to the lunar surface. Listen to the 1201 and the 1202 program alarms and Neil Armstrong just asking the ground so calmly, can I get a read on these alarms? And then you get the go call, I think it was from Steve Bales, relayed through Charlie Duke. Just fascinating stuff. None of that is going to happen if you are landing on Mars, right? Because the one-way light time is 10 to 20 minutes. So you could say, give me a read on that alarm, and 40 minutes later you're going to get an answer back. It's not going to help you. So mission control is going to be very different as we go further out. Okay. Data analysis, I mentioned the engineering positions, but we also have, right, the science data is coming in. You got a science team analyzing that. And really, it is about the operational decisions we make that determine mission safety and mission success. Ultimately, these are decision systems that we're building. Okay, so I mentioned a little bit of this inputs into design. And so, for example, if you take the Lunar Rover mission, right, and we're in the early formulation phase and I'm the mission operations manager, a lot of what I do is just make the kind of inputs I was describing earlier, talking about what happens if we go into orbit, what are the operational implications for that. I'm just throwing out an example flight rule that we expect to have. So that means we go into a shadow, we are only on battery power and the clock is ticking the minute we go in, right, because we don't want to fall below that 20%. Okay. All right, so I'm going to say a few things about Resource Prospector from an operational standpoint, and I'm going to try and generalize that enough that it's useful to you. So I mentioned the short distance from the Earth to the Moon. So that does give us near real-time command and control, right? If you are operating Curiosity on Mars, you are sending up a very long sequence, which is executed over a day or two, and you are not monitoring that sequence in real time. You have a comm pass once or twice per day, where you're basically in an analysis role, right? We have near real-time command and control, which means we can react to what we see on those sensors in real time, which makes our whole process of driving, sniffing, and reacting work. It also changes the way we drive the rover. Curiosity is going to have these long sequences of drives. You know, right? We can go in very small increments, waypoint to waypoint, and make our decisions as we go. One of the key elements in enabling us to do this mission is, well, enabling us to do it or making our productivity smaller than what we want it to be is the ground-based decision time. And we see this in field tests. So, you know, if we drive a few feet, spend an hour discussing it, another few feet, and another hour discussing it, we are not going to get where we want to go. So the length of time of that decision cycle is something we're trying to figure out through simulation. But, you know, simulations are great, but once you get on the lunar surface, you have a natural tendency to be careful with your space assets, and that can create a degree of conservatism that affects what you do. And I expect you guys are used to the idea of agile development, right? Agile development depends on the train leaving the station every couple of weeks. And if you have a train that only leaves the station every few years, it's going to alter your behavior, no matter what you say ahead of time. Okay. Current communication systems, and this is something you want to think about for a lunar port, right? The Deep Space Network, which is a fantastic asset, is really designed for deep space. Mars, the asteroid belt, Jupiter, and beyond. So if you've got a round-trip light time that's hours long, a few seconds doesn't matter, so you're not designing for that. But if you want to operate in lunar space, a few seconds absolutely matters. So, you know, I dream of a dedicated, you know, high data rate laser comm network that where we don't have to compete for when we use it and where we don't have this variable length of our round trip comm time, which actually has a big impact on our mission design. So it's possible we'll send a command and within, say, 6 seconds, we'll know what's happened. But we can't count on that. It might be 25 seconds. It might be 40 seconds. I tend to be an optimist. I think it'll be closer to six. But we can't count on that. So that's actually a big issue in our ops design. I mentioned the short duration surface mission. So when you have a week to operate, you have to very carefully manage what you're doing. Very little margin. Solar power and batteries, That's because we're a Class D mission, meaning we're allowed to take a degree of higher risk than, say, Class A, Class B, even a Class C mission. And if we had nuclear power, which is what would be really optimal for operating on the moon, we no longer are a Class D mission and we'd be much more expensive. So we have to manage batteries and solar power. So, I remember one night I was sitting at home and I was like, all of a sudden got this, oh God, what if we go into fault protection in a shadow when we're down to, 25% battery, you have these just nightmare thoughts that you don't want to have. So hopefully that will never happen. We do 24/7 operations, at least that is our plan. For longer duration missions, you'd have other options, I would say, for how that ground team would be deployed, because 24/7 operations over time becomes very expensive. I'm going to talk a little more about lighting and shadow, and I've already mentioned the Class D, so let's go on. Okay, so we have to have a structure for driving. I can't just say, okay, you guys go up to the moon and drive, and have the science team be debating every 5 seconds what we're going to do. And the science team is very much on board with this, so here's what we've come up with. We'll see if that changes by the time we fly. Stations and rails. So at a station, that's a point for science exploration. And the scientists are definitely directing where we're going and what we're doing. Whether we're doing searching, drilling, augering, the scientists are in charge. On rails, we are just getting from here to there. And my point is not to do stations or rails. My point is have a structure and a cadence to your mission that you've determined beforehand, and adapt and iterate as you go if you need to, but have that structure. Now, at any point, even on rails, right, if we drive over the equivalent of a puddle, the science team can call an interrupt and say stop and explore further. And we'll have a protocol for that, and once again, we need some set of predetermined thresholds for that that's encoded operationally in flight rules and procedures. Otherwise, you get an unstructured, how shall I say it? Let me just say you won't make optimal use of your time if you don't have some sort of a structure and a cadence. So here's an example traverse plan that you probably can't read very well. But you'll see what we've marked out is where we meet our success criteria, where we're doing each activity, right? Area of interest mapping, surface assay. And you can see in red where the permanent shadows are. And my point is not that we will do this traverse. My point is we have to do detailed analysis of many possible traverses just to validate that the mission is doable given the lighting and shadow conditions, which are constantly changing at the poles, right? In any given spot, if we stay long enough, we'll be in the shadows. And given our solar power, we need to carefully manage where we are. Okay, I'm going to try and get a little bit more generalizable here. This is just my table of contents. Okay, I've touched a little bit on near real-time command and control and reactive operations. I guess my broader point, I think we have an innate urge, desire, and you know when I talk to you later, you guys can give me your take on this. People want to do things in space, right? You want to make those decisions in space. Some people call that submarine mode, where you're kind of self-contained and you're doing everything independently. But when you're close to Earth, there's no set of constraints or engineering reasons why you have to do things in space. There's some cases like the space shuttle, right? Clearly that's a vehicle that takes off and lands, and pilots want to fly. But even there, you could do a lot of that now autonomously. A lot of the space station is flown from the ground. I think that's counterintuitive. I think you would expect it to be flown from space. But the point is, we can do these things from the ground, and it's often more efficient because astronaut time is so valuable, so precious, and so expensive. So when you're thinking about your system design, and you are in the vicinity of the moon, you've got a lot of options for where to distribute what you want to do, and it doesn't all have to be done in space. Some of those things could be done on the ground, given this near real-time command and control capability that you have. So I threw out autonomy as an example. You could build an autonomous robot, and that may be a highly desirable thing to do, or you could use people on the ground if you think it would be more cost-effective. So planning, typically, we have strategic planning, tactical planning, and reactive planning, right? Strategic planning over some period of time, What's my strategy? What do I want to get done? Tactical is the actual short-term implementation of that. And in missions, that's tended to go in natural cycles driven by the constraints that we have. So if you take an Apollo lunar surface EVA, right, the crew can only be out there so long. They're breathing consumables. You've got X number of hours to get things done. You've got a strategic plan for what you want to do. And then I'm going to take an Apollo 17 example where Harrison Schmitt, the only geologist to walk on the moon, saw orange soil and he wanted to go and explore, which he did. And the minute he goes off plan to explore that orange soil, which was definitely the right thing to do, a tactical planner on the ground says, okay, I don't have any more time on the surface that I had before. I now have to adjust my plan to what's happened in real time. A strategic planner is then looking at the whole mission, saying, okay, how does this affect me over some longer period of time? In the case of Resource Prospector, that's a week. In the case of Lunar Port, it's going to be a lot longer than that. And I keep stressing the reactive here because that's a significant capability to be able to react to what you see in real time, but be really careful where your decision points are and sucking up time by making constant decisions on the ground. Some of our, you know, some objectives are more quantifiable than others. And I have a feeling for you, since you're talking fuel production, right? That's a very quantifiable objective, much more so than just, you know, exploring the surface of the moon. Okay, data. Well, so this one's I feel really strongly about it because it has a huge impact on us. So I've mentioned this variable latency. And dreaming of that dedicated laser comm system that I'd like to have. But that we don't. And if you want to put your resources on Earth, which you can do, just remember you're going to require the data rates to support that from Earth to wherever your asset is in space. All right, let's talk a little bit about the poles. So there's probably some geologists out here. You know, if you look up at the moon and you're going to see the heavily cratered highlands, right, and then the mare, right, which are sparsely cratered and much darker when you're just looking at them with the eye. And the reason for that, right, age. So we date, if you are dating something on Earth, you're using radiometric dating. We have been to the moon, collected samples, done radiometric dating, and created some correlation of age to crater density. So if you want to date a surface on Mars, you're looking at crater densities. And we do the same thing on the moon. So the highlands, and you don't even need a telescope to see this, are very heavily cratered. And much brighter. So, mega regolith, 50 to 80 meters, deep, according to our lead scientist. Fewer rocks and smaller rock densities. But for driving, it's actually a big issue that we have negative relief. In other words, we've got all this fluff and then we've got these craters, which can be small. So I think that's going to be probably our biggest hazard for driving. We'll see when we actually get there. But for you folks who are going to be carting stuff around at the poles, that's the kind of terrain that we would expect you to be in. So what do we get? We get this impact gardening from micrometeorites, and then this fluff is settled by thermal cycling. But if you're at the poles, and if you're in the shadowed regions, you're getting less thermal cycling. A PSR, permanently shadowed region, that's a region that has not seen sunlight for a geologically significant period of time, meaning hundreds of millions of years or a billion years. That's a long time to not have seen light, right? Great movie script, maybe. So no thermal cycling is going on in there because the temperature is a steady, very cold, you know, in the 40 to 50 degrees Kelvin range, 40 to 50 degrees K, that is super cold. So we don't know what we'll really find in terms of soil characteristics there. If you read your Apollo history, you'll see that there were people who were concerned that the lunar module was simply going to sink into the dust. That didn't happen. We're designing for fluff. And we'll see what we find when we actually get there. And how are we doing that? So if you've ever had your car stuck in the mud, right, you know what this is like. So big wheels and then ribs on these wheels. Big wheels so we don't sink and ribs so that we have something to grab with. And then, of course, independent wheels, a little more capability probably than your car has. Okay, so I mentioned PSR. So the best place to search for volatiles is definitely in a region that has been in shadow and seen no sunlight that would evaporate those volatiles. So the PSRs are the place we want to go. I mentioned the 40 degrees K. I still find that almost unfathomable. So that's minus 388 degrees Fahrenheit, minus 233 degrees C. I can't quite conceptualize that, but that's quite a number. So for us, we want to spend our time in the shadows, but we've got the solar and battery issues that we mentioned before, plus the unknowns of the soil. So I'm very confident we can get into a PSR. I'm somewhat confident we can get out, and I expect that we will. But given the uncertainties, I wouldn't expect that going into the shadows would be the first thing we do once we got there. And I'll also say that if you're a solar panel, you don't care if you're in permanent shadow or not. You just care if there is light. And the shadows begin before we get to the permanently shadowed areas. So we've got quite a challenge navigating, driving through those shadows. So, oh, we can't read this. This is the crater. Where we did, I'm just going to show you a quick analysis of what those PSRs look like. That's permanent shadow. That's permanent shadow. The rest of this, we just have to manage the light. Okay, so ice stability depth map. So we're looking at where ice is stable, once again, over geologically significant periods of time. So white is the PSR, right? That's always in shadow, and we're going to have ice. But then we've got a stability depth 240 meters square per pixel here. And you can see with the red and the blue where we're looking at 1 meter, and the point is our drill is 1 meter, so that's the map that we need to plan the mission. All right, so lighting on the moon's a little bit different, obviously, than on Earth or even on Mars, right? We don't have any atmosphere. We have nothing to scatter the light. So the optics for driving are gonna be a little bit different than what we might be used to. So the shadows are almost pure black, right? Because we don't have this reflection. We do have some interior reflection, right? We've got sunlight bouncing off of craters and walls. We've got a little bit of Earth shine, and then we've got starlight, but we're still talking black, black. Oh, so to state kind of the obvious, we do need our own lights. If you actually go into a simulated lunar environment and you turn the lights on, sometimes it can actually make it worse than with the lights off, depending on how things reflect off the surface. So obviously we need a design for that. We can't afford a LiDAR, but you guys can afford sensors that we can't afford. And my point is, a lot of this driving around, the optimal way to do it may not be optics. You might want to think about other types of sensors. And we would have a LiDAR if we could afford it. This is courtesy of JAXA, just an example of what the lighting looks like at the lunar poles. Okay, so you do need to know where you are. If you're gonna go extract resources, you need to know where those are, and we need to know where you are. So for us, we're using, and I am you, a star tracker, wheel odometry, but then once again, wheel odometry is ambiguous, right? So what if you're driving and your wheels are slipping around and you're not going anywhere? So you don't wanna work just on wheel odometry. If any of you are geologists out here, you may have been stuck out in the middle of who knows where with a contour map, and you may be doing sightings, trying to figure out where you are, and we do something similar just by looking at a digital elevation map and looking at the map and trying to figure out where we are. It's a lot like a geologist out in the field. I really want to pull my phone out at a meeting and say, can't we just use the phone to see where we are, but I've never had the guts to actually do that. Okay, so I mentioned thermal, and I've harped on this temperature because I'm fascinated by it, but when you are going to design a system to operate in that thermal environment, you better make it survivable and capable of going through different thermal regimes, including warmer, right, and the colder. The lunar day-night cycle is 28 days, and I'll show you a graph on the next page, but if you're a rover designer or any sort of space asset designer, you have to design for that thermal regime. So maybe you guys will be mining for resources inside those permanent shadows, and maybe you'll need to build something that can survive in a continuous 40 degrees K. And if you do that, you're going to need a power source, right? And maybe that's a nuclear power source, but nuclear power source gives off heat, which will melt your ice, so you'll need to manage all that. Remember in The Martian when he was using those RTGs, right, and it was getting too hot inside there anyway. Great way to explain that to folks who might not otherwise think about that. So we are going to be up here, and we have to be in the summer, right? Because otherwise we have no light. So here's our temperature graph at 89 degrees latitude. But take a look at the temperature where we actually want to be. So at least it's not variable. It's just a little bit on the cold side. But for you folks designing Lunarport, and I don't know where all the distribution of your assets is planned to be, you've got a range of temperatures that you'll have to look at and design for. This is really the same information, just in more visual terms. Somebody has to tell me what a bolometer is. I have to look, I think I have to look that up on Wikipedia when we're done. Okay, so I am not a rover thermal control person, but the rover guys did give me this example of how they're designing the thermal control system. From an operations standpoint, what I want to know is how are we monitoring this in real time? Where are those decisions in real time? We'll have models and analysis, then we'll have the reality of what we actually encounter on the surface, which would be unusual if those two are not different. Over time, you can update those models. But initially, I'd expect a lot of attention to be given to the thermal status of our subsystems and that thermal position. We have a dedicated position just for thermal because we think it's that important. Okay. So I just thought this was really fun is the bottom line here, right? So I've mentioned this already, which is, you know, you can think about where to distribute your tasks because you've got the option of doing things on Earth. So just as an example, the stereo processing for a Mars rover is done on board on the flight software, right? But for our lunar rover, we do it on the ground. And so, right, single event upsets, radar, I'm sure you guys, if you're designing for space, have heard these things. Any processor that you fly in space, which is going to be space qualified, is going to be years behind because it takes years to space qualify something. Some of the commercial companies, I think, are going to fly, maybe some of you SpaceX guys know, right? Probably fly more commercial processors, and I don't know that they go through all that, and maybe they are single event upset tolerant, or maybe the whole system is. But my point is, it's very easy to put a tremendous amount of computational power on Earth, and maybe somebody, if you had the comm bandwidth, could just build AWS for space, which I thought sounded very fun and cool. Okay, and my last slide, we throw around the word autonomy a lot. Different people have different thoughts on what that actually means, but the holy grail of a lot of these things is considered autonomous operations where the space vehicle can operate itself. Whether you extend that to a full understanding of goals and you are putting actual goal-based decisions on board a space vehicle, it's something we discuss and certainly something you can consider. And between full autonomy and the more direct attention we give a space vehicle now is this idea of lights out operations, right? And notifications, where I don't have to watch my 160,000 parameters all the time because they're watching themselves, but I'm going to get a notification and I'm going to be brought into the decision loop at under appropriate event-driven sets of circumstances. So anyway, food for thought as you're designing your lunar base, which I can't wait to see. Okay, that's all I had. I just want to acknowledge all the folks on the team who I borrowed content from, our project manager, Dan, our lead scientist, Tony, rover guy, Matt, and on my ops team, Mark Shirley. And that's all I had. Definitely got time for a few questions.
All right, do we have questions?
Thank you very much for the presentation. To speak to something you were talking about at the end, autonomy, is there a plan for the resource prospector to have sort of a staged autonomy, like maybe something different in the beginning and then it morphs into something later?
Not over a one-way mission because our duration is too short.
Okay, so it's a one-way mission.
And our rover drivers would love autonomy. You know, it's just what we are a low-cost mission, so for practical reasons, we won't have autonomy.
Makes sense. Thank you.
Hi, thanks for the talk.
Sure.
So you mentioned nuclear quite a few times.
I did, yeah. You can tell what I wish we had, right?
Yes. So in that consideration, is it mostly cost or engineering or political reasons that are, or something else that's driving that decision?
So I mentioned that we're a Class D mission, mm-hmm. right, which is low cost. And Class D mission puts you in a certain risk posture. That doesn't mean you go out and take risks for risk's sake. It means you manage risks and you are allowed to take a higher risk posture in targeted areas than you could on another mission class. So if we were to have nuclear power, our costs would just go up way beyond our budget, and our risk posture would change, and the level of analysis that would go into the mission would change dramatically. And you've seen, right? You've seen on Mars, for example, right? Remember the Viking landers were nuclear powered, and then Pathfinder and the MER rovers were solar powered, and Curiosity is nuclear powered. But it was, I mean, nobody expected the MER rovers to go for years, right? Those were 90-day rovers. One of them is still going. That's from 2004. It was supposed to go for 90 days. This is 2017. One of them is still going. So I don't know that anybody expected that with a solar-powered rover, right? You get dust on the solar panels. Anyway, interesting trade space.
Yes.
Thank you. I'm wondering what the kind of physical distance between the edge of a PSR is defined, like the edge of the ocean and where the ice starts to be, is thought to be. Is this something that you could have a foot in one and a foot in the other, or is there like a 10 meter gradient?
The edge of a PSR and where the ice stops?
Starts. I mean, like, what's the gradient? What are the gradients you're talking here? We did see that the map with the blues and reds and so on, but what would be the steepest kind of example?
You know, and the answer is I don't know those numbers. I could certainly get them for you. but, you know, can we answer that with certainty before we go there? Probably not. And I think also it's a matter of depth. There we go. That's all I know. 240 meters per pixel. But we only look down to where we think the ice stability depth would be at 1 meter because our drill is 1 meter. And one thing I can tell you about the distribution of volatiles on the moon is that it is very uneven and poorly understood. So if you were to look at Mercury, you've got a much more even distribution of volatiles relative to what would be expected. On the moon, the one thing I can tell you is that we just don't know.
So I mean, there's like regions towards the left of that plot where you go from white to gray in a single pixel. So it could literally, like, all things being equal, be a very short distance.
It could, but I would be hesitant to give you an answer that I had any confidence in there.
I have a question about LiDAR as well. So you said that it was too expensive to do LiDAR, and we understand that Google's LiDAR system is about $125,000, but there are a number of much lower cost MEMS-based LiDAR systems entering the market in response to the autonomous car market. So what's the kind of overall budget at which LiDAR becomes way too expensive?
So yeah, you know, that's something I would have to go with. The rover team just says that it is outside the scope of our budget. So are those systems space qualified? Can they operate in a vacuum? Can they deal with the thermal regime that we have? What's their size? What's their mass? Can they fit in the space that we have would be the questions I'd ask. And I will definitely go back and say, these guys at Caltech said this cost of this is coming down. Guys, why can't we do it? I'll see what happens.
I'll use this for the benefit of the viewers online. By 5 years from now, you know, we can expect some change in that market, not to mention alternative IR
right.
systems
and
like the Microsoft Connect or something.
When in the design flow do we have to make those decisions? You know, we certainly have some time, but if we're going to fly in 5 years, right, we'd have to go with whatever's available probably 2 years from now would be my guess. But
yeah.
Point taken, and I'll certainly go back and mention that.
Cool, I hope it works.
Other questions? Yeah, down here.
So you talked about communications a lot. And so are you planning to have communications with direct line of sight between your rover and Earth?
We are, which is also right. So don't go driving behind some big giant rock where you lose communications and have a fault protection system on the vehicle that knows how to get calm back if you lose it. I'm jumping in already before you even finish your question. I'm sorry. Obviously, you know, you get me going on these things.
Yeah, it's a scary thought that you lose your rover. But Is that possible because you're only on a week-long mission? Does the, or are there lots
of places? You're not going to have DTE, right, what do? Right, you'd have to have, you could have a relay satellite, or you could potentially have, right, a lander with an antenna which talks to the rover, but then you've still got line of sight issues. On Mars, they have the science satellites, which also double as comm relays. But they also do a lot of DTE comm on Mars. But yeah, that is our assumption.
Okay.
Part of our goal is to demonstrate that we can do a NASA rover at much lower cost than what has been done before. So we have to, you know, we have to, well, we have to make a certain set of, you know, decisions and stick with those.
I guess this is kind of an autonomy question. So higher level, I don't know if this has been, I don't know if you know an answer for this, but so if you, for this specific mission, let's say you lose line of sight comm.
Yes.
And then, but you still have solar power. And then you suddenly go into a region where you're low on solar power and your state of charge drops. And you're freaking out. So
yeah,
this, can it autonomously?
I'm freaking out now just thinking about it, but yeah.
So can it, does the vehicle have ability to autonomously get into a solar region?
So
regardless of comm?
Those discussions are just starting, which is how do we do fault protection? And, you know, so right, you lose comm, and if your battery state of charge is low, what do you do? Do you go back to the last known spot where you had comm, which you could do, depending on the situation with light and your battery state of charge? Do you go forward if you think you know where you are? So that, yeah, so fault protection for this particular mission is going to be a really interesting discussion. But those decisions have not been made. And what I'm telling you is some of the trade space that we're discussing right now. And I would say the same even if you're in a shadowed region, right, and you've got X amount of time to get out. Do you just retrace your path back, which is a known path, or do you go forward into an unknown path? Very interesting discussions. And whatever we decide now, right, when we actually get there, we'll see. But that's what makes this mission operationally really interesting, I think, are those sorts of decisions.
Other questions?
Well, let's all thank our speakers.